schauen wir uns den nächsten Trailer an.
My name is Marcus.
My name is Connor.
My name is Kara. I am one of them. This is our story.
I think who Kara is, or how I would describe Kara, depends entirely upon who's playing her, because you have the option to make her multiple different people depending on the choices she makes. But I think she does start out incredibly naive, incredibly innocent, and kind of hapless.
I'm sure we used to be friends before I was reset. Maybe we can be friends again.
She's a person who's characterized, I think, by empathy. She's a person who really, she just comes from her heart.
You'll never leave me, right? Promise you'll never go.
I promise.
Kara! Are you okay? Are you hurt? Wait a minute! Leave her alone! Kara! Leave her alone!
The really beautiful thing that I've had the gift to be able to do is to essentially build a person from the ground up, because that's what she's doing throughout the game. And with every experience she has and every person she meets, she's building, you know, first emotions and then the sense of judgment. And it's sort of an exploration of what it is to be a human.
Don't worry. Luther and I will be right here.
David and the creators have painted a really intriguing and engaging picture of a near future where we rely upon androids for a lot of our service class business, our the class that serves us, that helps us, that handles our, that is our baristas and our drivers and our housemaids. And what is humanity, where we tap into it, how and why we treat each other the way that we do. And my character Marcus has a really intriguing journey, becoming deviant, realizing that he actually has feelings and human qualities inside of him, and it's a really incredible ascension into becoming fully realized and coming to terms with what you actually deserve better than this in life. And not only do you want it for yourself, but you want it for your peers.
We've come here to demonstrate peacefully and to tell humans that we are also living beings. All we want is to live free.
You know what? This thing, Dad, is not your son. It's a fucking machine!
I think that a group that feels marginalized, feels disenfranchised, feels like they deserve and have earned access to themselves and the environment around them, and are trying to figure out a way to articulate how to get freedom.
Connor is analytical. Connor takes things literally. He starts in the beginning place where he's very mechanical. He feels nothing inside, of course, and it's all just a system, a protocol that he's executing to get whatever he wants to happen, which is help humans stop deviants and to find the link between deviant androids.
You were designed to serve humans, not kill them! What was I designed to be? Their slave? Their toy?
Just say, I killed him! Is it that hard to say?
Stop it! Stop!
But of course, over the course of the story, and depending on the player's choices, Connor can grow in many different ways. He can deviate from that procedure or not.
The moment of truth, Hank. Am I a living being? Or just a machine?
Das war auch ein krasser Trailer. Da hat man noch mal mehr von den Hauptcharakteren gesehen, wie man wohl auch am Titel des Trailers erkennen kann. Aber es ist schon ziemlich cool zu sehen, wie das Ganze funktioniert. Wir werden uns jetzt, wie gesagt, noch die anderen Trailer anschauen, die ich eben noch nicht kenne, obwohl ich glaube, dass ich jetzt den hier schon kenne. Wie gesagt, von dem und dem habe ich Ausschnitte gekannt und den hier vorne habe ich sowieso gekannt, aber sonst sind die, glaube ich, zum größten Teil welche, die mir noch unbekannt sind. Also den Soundtrack kenne ich auf keinen Fall. Den Chloe-Kurzfilm auch nicht und sonst eigentlich das meiste hier auch nicht.
Fragen stellen, um sie besser kennenzulernen.
Ja, haben wir die Umfrage... Gibt es eine neue Umfrage? Ja.
Wer ist Ihr Lieblingscharakter in Detroit?
Ach, sowas gibt es. Eine weitere Umfrage. Das ist jetzt schwer zu sagen. Connor ist schon cool. Er ist in meinem Weg immer so ein bisschen Badass drauf und versucht halt um jeden Preis die Abweichler zu bekommen und wird dann am Ende selbst zu einem Abweichler. Kara gibt halt alles auf. Markus gibt eigentlich alles auf, was er hatte. Wegen Leo. Und Kara muss fliehen. Also Markus ist irgendwie schon einer der coolsten Charakter, würde ich sagen. Was aber auch irgendwie damit zusammenhängt mit Carl. Ich mag sehr die Szenen mit Carl. Also ich schwanke jetzt irgendwie so ein bisschen zwischen Connor und Markus. Ich will natürlich nichts gegen Kara sagen, aber ich finde Connors und Markus' Story schon ein bisschen cooler. Ich würde sogar schon fast eher sagen Connors Weg, weil damit entscheidet man schon ziemlich sehr, in welche Richtung das Spiel geht.
Gab es einen Moment in Detroit, der Sie ganz besonders berührt hat?
Also eigentlich so circa von ganz am Anfang bis ganz ans Ende. Eigentlich oft.
Was war Ihre härteste Entscheidung in Detroit?
Mit Kara Ellis Identität akzeptieren? Nein. Und mag es friedlich oder gewalttätig sein, mit Connor entscheiden, Chloe zu erschießen? Die beiden waren wichtiger. Das hier war jetzt ehrlich gesagt kein Problem. Gibt's nur die drei? Ich würde jetzt eigentlich davon sagen, dass keins hiervon jetzt so mega schwer zu entscheiden war. Mit Markus war klar, dass ich friedlich bin, mit Connor entscheidend Chloe zu erschießen. Ich wusste von Anfang an, dass ich sie nicht erschießen will. Ich musste natürlich abwägen, aber eigentlich war das mir klar und das mit Markus eben auch. Ja, das ist jetzt schwierig. Ich würde schon fast eher sagen, mit Markus friedlich oder gewalttätig sein. Ich weiß es nicht. Ich mache das einfach mal. Ich habe auch bei dem hier unten ziemlich viel gehangen, aber glaub schon eher das hier. Okay. Ach so, das ist jetzt... Ah, ich muss ganz nach hinten. Ah ja, okay. Connor 49%, okay. Wow, Markus da ganz als letzter. Okay. Oft hatten auch die meisten. Und hier, härteste Entscheidung, Detroit. Mit Markus friedlich oder gewalttätig sein. Klar, Kara Ellis Identität akzeptieren, dass das 14% doch als die schwierigste Entscheidung angesehen haben von den drei. Ich weiß, wahrscheinlich ist das auch für die nicht die schwierigste Entscheidung im Spiel gewesen, aber die schwierigste von den drei, die da stand, und das finde ich schon krass. Bei mir war das würde das irgendwie ganz weit hinten sein. Da war es für mich. Dafür war für mich einiges anderes deutlich schwieriger. Okay.
Sie haben gestern lange gespielt. Hoffentlich sind Sie nicht müde.
Ja, ich habe halt aufnehmen müssen. Sorry.
Das ist der Abschnitt extra.
Ja, ich weiß.
Beim Spielen schalten Sie viele Inhalte frei, die Sie hier wiederfinden.
Ich würde sagen, machen wir mit Detroit eine interaktive Geschichte weiter. Detroit, an interactive story.
Game after game, we tried to challenge ourselves. For Detroit, we wanted to, first of all, to write a story that would be incredibly bending, which means the most non-linear story that we've ever created. And we wanted really the player to have the possibility to change the story, change his own journey.
When you're writing at Quantic, you're writing for an interactive medium. You know, when you're working in television, you'll put a character in a difficult situation, and you as a writing team will argue about what would that character do. But ultimately, you have to decide what happens, and you just show the audience. What's interesting about interactive drama is you bring the player into that conversation, and it changes your job slightly as a writer, because your job is to provide a narrative context in which the player can write his own story. You're giving him this kind of narrative Lego that he's going to snap together into his own shape. You also have the ability to make your audience attach themselves to your characters, because the audience is in some sense responsible for what happens to the characters.
It's just a few cans.
Come on, let's go. We have some cash now.
You used me to steal that money. How could you do that? I trusted you.
What is a bit specific about this this scripts is how large they are. If you take a film script, there are about 100 pages. But here we have to deal with script that is between 4,000 and 5,000 pages. Everything becomes bigger because we don't just tell one story, but we tell all the possible stories that can be told within this narrative space.
On Act 3, our final act, we have around 1,000 different scenarios. And every one of those scenarios has to be as interesting, as passionate, as strong, and as emotional for the player. We want every action that the player does, every interaction that is available to serve in telling the story, and help the player understand who his character is, and build that character moment to moment. We started with the intention pretty early on that we would never lie to the player. So we implemented a visible tree structure in the game that players can consult during a scene or at the end of it, which shows exactly what they did and what they missed. There are games out there offering world exploration. We offer narrative exploration.
You know, keeping control of such a wide and large story is a huge challenge. So, same thing when you shoot with actors, because you will need to shoot many different versions of each dialogue, of each scene. For actors, it's a huge, huge challenge.
Because of the style of the game, you have so many different ways that the character can go. Every decision, it's what I call kind of choose your own adventure. Like every decision that the player makes, it's going to open up 40 more pages of material and experience that ties in, which means as a performer, you have to try to continue to make things feel real that the player might not ever see, but also that in performance, it's not always connected to a previous act. It's grueling, it's hard work, but it's a great team, and I enjoy doing it.
I was really frustrated, I was, until I got to this point where I kind of was able to step outside of my own experience, and even in a lot of ways, my own process, and be able to step outside of that, and okay, this is something new, what do you need? How do I meet you there? How do I give you what you need and still feel like I'm doing what's right? And once I did that, then all of a sudden it got really fun. It was much freer, and having to approach it in a new way and think about the player and think about how it serves them and what I'm doing for them or what I'm letting them into. It's really, I think, helped me grow in general.
Remember, there's nothing on the left, that's all. So it's probably all there. And then make her come first, close. But I think you would go first to check that it's safe.
Okay, sure.
The most enjoyable thing about working in performance capture on this kind of project is that if I shot a film, I would get to do one of these endings. I get to do so many different things as Connor. Your head goes all over the place because you're trying to keep track of basically four different storylines for each different response.
What's the name of my dog?
Buddy? Scout. I think it's Jack. I can't remember. So I worked with physicality a lot because it was a good way to anchor myself in these different rings of the tree. As the story grows out, I know where that is physically in my body, and then I can switch more continually on set, and it'll be entirely up to the player to determine what order those things come out and what they look like from a distance. Like if you're playing through it, the culmination of all of that will be their version of Connor.
I'm faster than you, and I don't feel pain. You don't stand a chance against me.
Listen, asshole. If it was up to me, I'd throw the lot of you in a dumpster and light a match to it.
Tourner les scènes d'action à...
Shooting action scenes at Quantic Dream is a real challenge, because these are scenes where the storytelling has to continue. It's not an action scene just to have a dose of adrenaline. The stunts have huge consequences on the rest of the story. It's really a moment where we implicate the player and tell him that the choices he makes during an action scene will have a direct impact on the evolution of his story.
Mon plus grand défi sur Détroit aurait...
My biggest challenge on Detroit has been managing the large number of animations that we received from motion capture. Detroit features more than 37,000 animations, which is a huge amount to handle on a daily basis.
Donc il faut prendre conscience que...
You have to realize that the player, in his first playthrough, will miss certain scenes. This also means that we had to think of, conceive, and produce all the potential story paths. The characters' costumes, the places, day or night, the weather. Did the character get shot in the shoulder? Did he get injured? All this consistency forced us to produce a lot of graphic assets in order to, quite simply, allow the player to have true continuity throughout the story.
Honestly, we were even surprised by the challenges that come with such a big tree structure. And we did our best to guarantee quality across all the game and make sure that whatever path you choose within this narrative space, you will have an equally good experience.
Okay, der Trailer ging jetzt auch nochmal in die Richtung von den beiden, sprich, man hat wieder so ein bisschen behind the scenes gesehen, die Motion Capture Aufnahmen, wie das Ganze war. Und es ging halt vor allem darum, dass es ziemlich viel Aufwand ist, eben diese ganzen verschiedenen Wege, diese ganzen verschiedenen Entscheidungen dem Spieler zu geben. Dass das sowohl als Schauspieler viel Aufwand ist, als auch wenn man am Spiel arbeitet, weil man natürlich dann nicht die Arbeit einmal machen muss, sondern irgendwie je nach Szene 4, 5, 6, 7 Mal hintereinander in verschiedenen Varianten, und ich kann mir vorstellen, schön war das auch nicht immer für die Leute. Schauen wir uns den nächsten Trailer an. Wie gesagt, ich will hier nicht zu lange hängen, deswegen machen wir weiter.